In 2 Samuel chapter 12, verse 13, we have only that David confessed his sin. He says, "There I have sinned against the Lord." There's nothing recorded in that verse or that passage to indicate the reality and the depth of David's repentance. And for that, thankfully, the Holy Spirit has graciously given us a record of David's inspired repentance found in Psalm 51. It is one of the few psalms that we are given the historical background. There's no guesswork as to why this is written. The inscription reads in verse 1, I'll read it again, a psalm of David, when Nathan the prophet came to him after he had gone into Bathsheba. That clearly identifies for us the incident out of which this psalm arose. It was a time when David became involved in the depths of sin that began with adultery and ended with murder. One word before I proceed. It has been asked who could properly expound this psalm, and I will raise my hand to say, I certainly do not qualify. Charles Haddon Spurgeon was the prince of expositors, a man who could get more out of a passage than just about anyone else. Yet in the preface of his work on Psalms, he tells how he postponed his working on Psalm 51 week after week, and often he would sit down to it and he would get up without having written even a line. He concluded, and I quote, "It is a bush burning with fire yet not consumed. And out of it a voice seemed to cry to me, draw not nigh hither, put off thy shoes from off thy feet." The psalm is very human. Its cries and sobs are one born of woman, but it is freighted with an inspiration all divine, as if the great father were putting words into his child's mouth. Such a psalm may be wept over, absorbed into the soul, and excelled again in devotion, but commented on, he says, where is he who, having attempted it, can do other than blush at his defeat? Well, with those words, I want to say this morning, I blush at my attempt and humbly approach this inspired passage of Scripture. It says in verse 1, David says as he prays, "Have mercy upon me, O God, according to thy loving kindness. According to the multitude of thy tender mercies, blot out my transgressions, wash me thoroughly from mine iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin." There are four things here that David asked the Lord for in these two verses. But before I get there, I just want to say, David's sin is horrifying. I mean, adultery and then to murder the husband, that's horrifying. But I want you to look at his response. What he does when he realizes the depths of his sin, his response should be our response to sin in our lives. First, he pleads for mercy. "Have mercy upon me. Oh God, have mercy upon me." Why? Why doesn't he plead for God's justice? Because mercy is the only basis by which we can approach a holy God. Sin is an illegal act. It's a violation of God's law. It's an act of lawlessness. It's rebellion. And therefore, it requires mercy. You know, sometimes people will say this, and they say it in ignorance, I'm sure. Well, they'll say, "God is just, and he's going to treat me justly, and I live better than, you know, most people. And, you know, in the end of all this, you know, God, he's going to see that, and that I'm a pretty good person." But trust me, you don't want justice. If we get what we deserve, which is what justice is, we're in big time trouble. Why? Because we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. Because there is none righteous. No, not even one. Because we're all guilty. And sometimes I say it like this, we're as guilty as a chicken, as a fox in the chicken coop. Blood running down your face. Huh? We're guilty. And if we get what we deserve, we're all dead men. David, therefore asked for mercy. What wisdom to ask for mercy. Because according to the law, he was a dead man. Because you see, for deliberate murder and adultery, the penalty was death. It was death. David knew that there was no offer or any gifts which he might present. He knew that apart from the mercy and the loving kindness of God, that he's through. It's over for him. He doesn't have a leg to stand on. So David appeals to the only thing he can appeal to. I mean, when you're guilty, when you're sentenced to death, I mean, what else can he do but appeal to the multitude of tender mercies, the infinite mercies of God? And if anybody needed those mercies, it was David. But I can tell you this, friend, so do you and so do I need the mercies of God. Because we're all deserving of judgment, just like David. And because we can't earn our own righteousness, all we can do is plead for mercy. That's all you can do. I don't know how many of you, when I was young, I remember this song they would sing, "Mercy drops round us are falling." Anybody remember that song? Some of you old timers, along with me. Yeah. Any young people? Yeah, Joyce, she's young. But the song would say, "Mercy drops round us are falling." But I'm so glad that that's not really, the song's okay, but it's not really correct. It's not little drops. It's a deluge of mercy. Thank God. He pours out his abundant mercies. And when God forgives, he forgives beyond our comprehension. I mean, it's beyond our comprehension how God forgives us. I mean, our sin is horrifying, but God's mercy, oh, it's beyond comprehension. The Bible gives us some figures of speech, and I just want to mention a couple this morning to depict the merciful forgiveness of our God. In Psalms 103, verse 12, it says this, "As far as the east is from the west," hear that now, "so far hath he removed our transgressions from us, as far as the east is from the west." Now, that's quite a distance, is it not? And why didn't God, you know, you ever think about this? Why did he say as far as the north is from the south? Well, think about it. You see, one could travel wherever they may be. Today we could go south to the South Pole, right? And then we could travel north to the North Pole and then travel south again to right back to our starting point. On the other hand, one could travel around the world millions of times going east, reaching the starting point over and over without ever traveling in any other direction but east. Do you see it? There is a South Pole and a North Pole, but there's no East Pole and no West Pole. In other words, there's no place where east meets west. If God had chosen the words north from south, then that would mean that there would be some eventual point where I would meet up with my sins again. But by carefully choosing the words from east to west, God is showing us that there will never be a point in the future where I will meet that sin that I've repented of ever again. Are you with me? You talking about mercy? Do you know that when God forgave David of adultery and murder, that as far as the east is from the west, he removed it from David? Can you imagine? Think of that. Then God says in Micah chapter 7, verse 19, "Thou wilt cast all their sins into the depths of the sea." The depths, the bottom, the abyss of the sea. And someone has added, and he puts up a sign that reads, "No fishing." You know, don't try to fish out old sins once God's already dealt with them. That's our problem. We try to fish them out. They're never going to be remembered against us again. No wonder David said, according to thy loving kindness, according to the multitude of thy tender mercies. Think of that. So the lesson we learn from David is, if we will be forgiven of sin, it will be because of God's infinite mercy. We don't deserve it. You could never deserve it. I don't care how you compare to somebody else. God doesn't grade on the curve. It's by this book. And we all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. So when we approach God, we approach God as a sinner worthy of death and destruction. And all we can do is plead for God's mercy. That's true repentance. You say amen? Amen. True repentance. This is further delineated here in David's description of his sin. David uses three corresponding words to describe the depths of his sin. He says in Psalm 51, verse 1, blot out my transgressions. Verse 2, wash me thoroughly from mine iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. These three words reveal that he had a profound awareness of his sin and of its nature. The first word is transgressions. You know what it means? It means it refers to a revolt or rebellion. You see, David's sin was not something done in ignorance. He willfully sinned. He knew adultery was wrong. He knew murder was wrong. He is a deliberate rebel against the known will of God. He knows he is. Amen? And then the second word is iniquity. This word conveys the idea of twisting or perverting. It usually refers to the depravity of our natures. It is the same word that we'll get to here in a little bit. In verse 5, he says, I was shapen in iniquity. You see, we are all born sinners. We're born with a depraved nature. And then the third word is sin itself. Sin means falling short or to miss the mark. We have all sinned and come short of the glory of God. We've all missed the mark. We've not any of us measured up to God's standard, not one of us. So not only does David have this keen awareness of the nature of his sin, but he wants to be rid of sin. I mean, if you truly repent, you want to be rid of that sin. You know, some people, I think they have the idea, well, you know, I can just keep sinning. I just need to ask God to forgive me. That's not true repentance. That's not repenting. No. He wants his sin to be removed. That's true repentance. David asked God to do three things with his sin. First, he says, blot out my transgressions. You know, the word blot out means to wipe it out. It means to rub it off. It means to wholly remove it. David's saying, Lord, make it as if though I've never rebelled against you. Will you just wipe the slate clean? It's the New Testament equivalent of justification by faith, meaning my sins are blotted out, just as if though they had never existed. That's what David is asking for. He's not wanting to continue in his sin. He's not embracing sin. A child of God doesn't embrace sin. Somebody that's truly repenting of their sin doesn't embrace sin and say, well, you know, I'm going to just dabble around in it now, God, but forgive me. So, you know, cleanse me so I'm okay, so I'm saved. But No, that's not true repentance. Come on, somebody. That's not what it means. David says, I want it out. I want it. Rub it out. Wipe it out, God. And not only blot it out, but he says, wash me thoroughly or thoroughly. The root meaning of the verb wash is to trample. The means of washing the clothes in those days was to trample the clothes. It's like David saying, wash me real good, Lord. I don't even want one little speck left. You see, he's dirty. He's dirty. He feels guilty. He has felt the guilt for some time and is getting dirtier and dirtier and dirtier. And he feels more and more alienated from God who is holy. Have you ever felt like that? You ever felt just dirty? Am I the only one? Huh? Felt dirty? Felt the guilt, the shame of the sin? And so he says, wash me. Wash me. Thoroughly wash me. It means to wash me multiple times. It's like he's saying, God, don't put me on the rinse cycle. I don't want to be on. Our washing machine has this setting that says express wash. And they said, I don't want the express wash. I don't want that. And then our we have another cycle on our washing machine. It's about had it, but it's got some cool names for the settings, you know. It's called whitest white. Now that's what David wanted. The whitest white. Lord, I want you to wash me in that cycle. With the whitest white. Wash me until it's all gone. See, David understands, he's implying his great guilt. And he said, God, I want this. I want it blotted out. I want you to rub it out. I want you to wash me till I'm clean. And then last, he says, cleanse me means make me bright, uncontaminated, make me pure. Sin had defiled him, made him filthy. And therefore, he desires to be washed, cleansed, purged from the pollution of sin. David wants it gone. Blot out. Here's what he's saying. Blot out my rebellion. Wash me from my depravity. Cleanse me from my sin. Wow. Talking about repentance. We don't embrace sin when we repent. We don't say, well, you know, I'm living in adultery and I know I shouldn't. And so, God, will you forgive me? And then we just keep saying, but I'm going to keep on doing what I'm doing. Huh? Come on. You want to know what repentance looks like, right? That's what you all said. So then David goes on to point out the way to lay hold of forgiveness. I mean, this is the attitude of his heart. I don't want this. You feel like that about anything in your life? Huh? Come on now. I'll lift my hand up, okay? So you rest of you need to pray just to get honest, okay? And then the rest of us be honest here and say, yeah, I got some things in my life. I just want them out. I don't want them. I don't want them in my life. We're going to have to get honest if we're going to truly repent. I don't want this. I don't want this in my life. And so David now goes on to point out the way of forgiveness. He says in verse 3, For I acknowledge my transgressions. I acknowledge. I'm admitting it. Got to get honest if you want to truly repent. And my sin is ever before me. Oh, boy. Oh, boy. Been there, done that. Against thee, thee only, have I sinned and done this evil in thy sight, that thou mightest be justified when thou speakest and be clear when thou judgest. You see, back in the text in chapter 12 of 2 Samuel, verse 13, David confesses, I have sinned against the Lord. But here he's saying, I am conscious of my transgressions, of my rebellion. I'm guilty. My sin is ever before me. And David wants them blotted out because he can't handle the guilt. God's been dealing with his heart. Huh? His heavy hand is pressed sore upon him. You remember we talked about the conviction of God. God would not relent day and night. You ever had God deal with you like that? My sin is never out of my mind, David is saying. It continually oppresses my spirit. I lay it before thee, O God, because it's ever before me. Lord, take it away. Against thee and thee only have I sinned. Now, of course, we know that he had sinned against others, Israel, Uriah, Bathsheba, his family. I mean, he true repentance gets to the place where we say, but my true sin is before God. David realized that God was there. And God was looking when he did his evil. God was not absent from the bedroom of adultery or the place where David commanded Uriah be killed. God saw it. And folks, I'm going to tell you, God sees everything. Even when you think nobody else sees or anybody else knows, God sees it. And we need to be aware of the fact that God is watching. He sees everything. He even knows the intents and the motives of our heart, which you're so adept at hiding from everybody else. We are. But God sees and God knows. I'm talking about sin and I'm talking about repentance here. Verse 4 indicates that David confessed for the purpose that God might be what? Justified when, he says, when you speak and blameless when you judge. He's saying, you would be blameless if you damn me or condemn me. He knew he deserved sin. He wasn't going to blame God. True repentance says, you're right and I'm wrong. That's what true repentance says. You're right and I'm wrong. You're right, God, and I'm wrong. You're just, God. I'm the one that's unjust. You're right. You know, some people, they say, you know, with God, you know, homosexuality, just leave those people alone. It's okay. You know, it's, you know, I had a, I don't know why I'm getting off on this, but Joyce read to me the other day, a lady, a minister, had preached a message about homosexuality, and it was sin, just from the Bible, just what God says about it. And so it went out in the internet or wherever, and people began to hear about it, and they began to just blast this person. And this well-known person said, you know what, now you need to learn this. Basically, I'm just paraphrasing, you need to have some wisdom. You know, if you're going to preach something like that, you probably need to collect all your cell phones and everybody, you know, get the ushers to collect them and you know, and just keep it in-house. Oh, what in the world is wrong with people? Somebody needs to tell people that adultery, sin, homosexuality, sin, it's an abomination to God. Abortion is murder. Somebody needs to stand up and say so. What in the world are we talking about? Don't take it out there. It needs to go out there. We preach the truth. We preach it in love. Jesus didn't come to condemn. I've been just recently heard this week that, you know, well, that church there, that, you know, that church there, they judge people. Listen, folks, we're not trying to judge anybody. We're just trying to do what God says. Jesus didn't even come to condemn. He didn't come for that. He came to save. Do you hear me? But here's what it goes on to say in John 3. It says, but here's the condemnation. That the light has come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light. You hear me? People don't want to hear the truth. They don't want the light, and that's what condemns them. But Jesus didn't come to condemn. He came to save. I'm not here to condemn anybody. I'm here to tell you, Jesus saves, and he'll save you. Okay, I'll get off my soapbox for a minute. I always get in trouble when I get off of my notes. But we don't say, well, that's okay. Homosexuality is okay. No, we say, God, society is wrong. You're right. We don't say, well, it's okay to commit adultery just because society says it's okay. No, we say, God, your word is right, and we're wrong. Society is wrong. Well, you know, it's okay if I just drink a few brewskis here and there. No, God's word is right, and society is wrong. The church is wrong if they say that. The church is wrong. God's word is always right. And that's what true repentance is. David says, you're right, God, and I'm wrong. You're just. You see, false repentance, on the other hand, justifies me. It rationalizes. It says, I don't deserve these consequences. God, you're too hard on me. And we make excuses. God, it's the circumstances you put me in. It's the parents. It's my raising. It's how I was raised in my parents' home. Or if you didn't allow me to marry this man or this woman, I would have never done this thing. And we want to blame God for our sin. We try to rationalize and make excuse. But no, David said, God, you're right and I'm wrong. You're right and I'm wrong. David takes full responsibility. That, my friend, is true repentance. Everybody with me, say amen. Then he takes it even further. He goes to the root of the problem. The root of the problem. It was his problem. It's your problem. It's my problem. It's the problem of all humanity. Verse 5, He says, behold, I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. You see, it wasn't that his mother had committed some kind of, it was what's referred to here is when he was born, from his very beginning, he was shapen, even in his mother's womb, in iniquity. David understands that his sin was not happenstance, a combination of unfortunate circumstances. He says, I realized that I was brought forth in iniquity, and sin my mother did conceive me. He said, I'm not only a sinner by choice, but I'm a sinner by nature. This was not intended to justify him in any way. It was meant to complete the confession. This is what we call, and this is important. You know, we need doctrine in the church today. And this is important. It's called the doctrine of original sin. How many of you ever heard of that? Oh, my goodness. Will we ever need to preach about that then? The doctrine of original sin is the idea that humans are born sinners. We've received a sinful nature as the sons of Adam. Hear me. I was brought forth. This is the doctrine of original sin. I was brought forth in iniquity. Twisted I came out of my mother's womb. It's as if though he said, not only have I sinned this once, but I am by my very nature a sinner. The fountain of my life is polluted as well as its streams. I naturally lean toward forbidden things. Is that not true? Mine is a constitutional disease. And in my sin, and in sin, did my mother conceive me? He goes back to the earliest moment of his being to acknowledge the deep roots of his sin. David is saying, I didn't sin to become a sinner. I sin because I am a sinner. Teaching us that we must repent not only of what we have done, but of what we are. We need to repent of what we are. Not just the things we do, but what we are. This is why, and I don't want to jump on another soapbox, but modern humanistic psychology is contrary to the Bible. Its premise is that we're inherently good. No. No, that's a wrong premise. You can't. We're not just a product of our environment. God says, no, we are by our nature sinners with a depraved nature. It's the doctrine of original sin. I hope you know that and remember that, because it affects everything you believe. It'll help you to recognize error. David is saying, I see now. He says sin is not just a surface problem that can be handled lightly. It's a deep-rooted problem. It has stained my whole nature. As the theologian Pogo said, we have met the enemy and he's us. David is saying, unless I find some solution for this polluted nature, I'll never be able to keep from falling back again into sin again and again and over again. I have to find a solution. Are you listening? You see why repentance is no shallow thing? No, it's more. It's much more. Have you ever faced the fear of repeating the same sin? Okay, I'm first. Oh Lord, what a fool I have been. You ever do something and you say, oh, I made a fool out of myself. I want all you holy people to come and pray for me today, please. When I see how easily deceived I was, how easily I stumbled into this thing, well, what's going to keep me from doing it again? Maybe next week, maybe tomorrow. What's going to keep me from doing this again? God, the heart's deceitful. Above all things, it's desperately wicked. In the flesh, The word says there's no good thing. And I'm still in this flesh. David's saying, I not only want pardon, I want to be purified. I want you to get down to the root of my problem. I want victory. I want victory. He continues verse 6. I'm heading toward the end. Behold, thou desirest truth in the inward parts, and in the hidden part thou shalt make me to know wisdom. David had been anything but truthful. For a year he had been hypocritical, deceiving. But now David understands God wants honesty, truthfulness. And he wants to get to the root of the problem. You see, God is looking at our heart. True repentance, true confession, understand God isn't, he's not content with a superficial change. God wants to change us from the inside out. God, don't just stop me at the point of adultery. Stop me long before that. Stop me at the point of lust. Because did he not say that once lust is conceived, it bringeth forth sin? Stop me there, God. Stop me right there. Don't even let me get beyond that. Stop me right there, Lord. Oh, stop me. You know, this idea of changing from the outside in is what religion's all about. It's what the Pharisees did. Jesus said, outwardly, you appear righteous. Inwardly, you're full of hypocrisy and iniquity. You see, religion never deals with this inside thing. It doesn't change us. No, we might conform to some rules of do's and don'ts. We're not changed. I mean, God's looking at the heart. What good does it do you to do something and it not be from your heart? Huh? So that's what they did. Outwardly, Jesus said, you're white as sepulchres. You appear to be beautiful, but inwardly, you're full of dead men's bones. You see, repentance occurs in the heart. From the inside, God begins to work in us. The change must occur. Truth, righteousness, where does it take place? It takes place in the heart. Now I'm going to, something really important here. Something really important here. David goes on to say, thou shalt make me to know wisdom. David needed wisdom. As we all do. But David, we've mentioned that David was in quite a pickle. I mean, what could he do? He's under the law. David confessed God is just and the law said he must die and he was guilty. So what recourse does David have? I mean, he's in the same dilemma that the woman caught in the act of adultery in John chapter 8. You know the story, Jesus, they is 1,000 years into the future, but the religious crowd brought her to Jesus, said the law of Moses said she must die. It's true. She committed adultery. Of course, the guy did too. They didn't bring him. But it was true. What recourse did she have? What recourse did David have? Wait a minute. What recourse do any of us have? I mean, the law says we all must die. The wages of sin is death. We've all sinned. We're all guilty. What recourse do you have? What do I have? But you see, God gave David wisdom. David remembers the first Passover. This is amazing. He goes back to before the law. You say, well, how do you know he went back before the law? Because look at verse 7. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Where'd this idea come from? Huh. It came from Exodus chapter 12, verse 22. God says, and you shall take a bunch of hyssop. Hyssop was a small plant used in those days as a small brush. And here's what God says, and dip it in the blood that is in the basin, and strike the lintel and the two side posts with the blood that is in the basin. Now, we know the blood came from what? The Paschal Lamb, the spotless Lamb, prefiguring Jesus Christ. He says, verse 23, well, it says, first of all, none of you shall go out of the door of this house until morning, for the Lord will pass through to smite the Egyptians. And when he seeth the blood upon the lintel and on the two side posts, the Lord will pass over the door and will not suffer, will not allow the destroyer to come into your houses to smite you. You see, David appealed to God for mercy on the basis of the Paschal Lamb. David went back to that first Passover night, and when God said, when I see the blood, I'll pass over you. It pointed toward Calvary. David looks to the cross of Christ. He may not have understood. I'm sure he didn't understand all about it, but he knew enough that the blood of a spotless lamb was required for the protection from the death angel. Now listen, he knew that. He, by faith, said, God, I have no recourse. The only thing I can do is go back from before the law and appeal to your mercy on the basis of the lamb that was slain. Oh, it's the way the woman caught in the act of adultery was saved from the stoning. It was Jesus, the spotless lamb, was about to shed his blood on the cross for her. David understood this. When he asked God to cleanse him with hyssop, he meant, cleanse me by the blood. That's what he was saying. He knew what that meant. Cleanse me by the blood. The word purge literally means descend me. I love this. David says, I want this. Sin had wrecked his life. I don't want this. Get it off of me, God. Get it out of my life. Descend me. How? On the basis that an innocent victim would die in his place. He looked ahead by faith to Calvary. There was no hope under the law. The law gives us none of us any hope. The law says we all must die. The law is good, Paul said, for this purpose, that it shows us how sinful we are. But the law cannot save you. The law will smite you. But David had received wisdom, insight, that his only hope was the blood of the Lamb. The law crieth death to the sinner. So David, that's what the only thing he can do. He goes to the blood of the Lamb, and friend, it's your only recourse as well. He looked forward to the cross. We look back to the cross of Christ by faith. That's how we're saved. That's how we repent, through the blood of Christ. Through the blood of Christ. Would you be free from your burden of sin? There's power in the blood. Power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. Oh, the songwriter knew. The songwriter knew. Let me close with this passage, this verse, as they come. Isaiah, the prophet, would some years after this event with David write to a rebelling nation, rebelling against God, some special words that Jesus, or that God, says to Israel. Isaiah 1, verse 18, come now, and let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. And though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. Come now, God says. God's saying, let's settle this. Let's settle this matter. Your good works, your righteousness can't clean the stain of sin. Your best intentions, your promises can't clean the stain. Your suffering, your pain cannot clean the stain. Time will not clean it. Death cannot clean it. But the blood of Jesus can. He can make us white as snow. Spurgeon writes regarding this verse, as eloquent as only he can do, he says, "Come now. No season can be better. If ye tardy till you're better, ye will never come at all. Come now. You may never have another warning. The heart may never be so tender as it is today. Come now. No other eyes may ever weep over you. No other heart may ever agonize for your salvation. Come now, now, now. For tomorrow you may never know in this world. Death may have sealed your fate. And once the filthy may remain filthy still. Come now, for tomorrow thy heart may become harder than stone. And God may give thee up. Come now. It is God's time. Tomorrow is the devil's time. Today, if you'll hear his voice, harden not your hearts, as in the provocation when your fathers tempted me and proved me in the wilderness and saw my works. Come now. Why delay to be happy? Would you put off your wedding day? Will you postpone the hour when you are pardoned and delivered? Come now. The bowels of Jehovah yearn for you. The eye of your father sees you afar off, and he runs to meet you. Come now." Would you come now? The Father yearns for you. Like with the prodigal son, he looks afar off, looking for you. Oh, God will allow you to wallow in the pig pen. In fact, that prodigal son wallowed in it until he came to his senses. Some of us need to come to our senses. He said, "In my Father's house there's plenty of bread. I'm out here starving. The servants have it better in my Father's house than I have it here." It's like the Father was saying, "Come now. Let's reason together. Is it making any sense what you're doing? The way you're living? Do you really think that it's okay with God?" Oh, I'm talking to me. Is it all right that we don't have our house in divine order? When God has made such a provision. I mean, we have no excuse. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Have you come to your senses yet? Well, what is the road you travel and going to lead to? Where's it going to take you anyhow? Have you stopped long enough to think ahead just a little while? I'm reminded of that great preacher, Dwight Moody. He'd gone to law school and he had all these plans for his life. One day he was sitting down in his office and the Lord spoke to his heart and said, what are you going to do when you finish your course, Moody? And he said, "Well, I'm going to hang a shingle. I'm going to start my law practice." And the Lord said, "Well, then what?" And Moody said, "Well, I'll make money." "Well, then what?" "Well, I'll retire." "Then what?" And suddenly it dawned upon Moody, that pretty soon this life runs out. And he thought, the judgment. I'm going to die, and then the judgment. I just want to ask you this morning. I just want to ask you. What are you doing with your life? Well, I hope to get a good job and make some good money. Well, then what? Well, I hope I marry a handsome guy and a good-looking girl. Well, then what? Have some kids? Then what? You see, pretty soon you come to face. You're going to have to face your life. Because sooner or later it's going to run out. And then what? Then what? Will you come to your senses today? Oh, I'm not just talking to the sinner today. I'm talking to the child of God who has compromised, knows what they're doing is wrong, knows it. There's no doubt about it. They know it, like David, and it's transgression. You openly rebel. You know what you're doing is wrong. But yet, you think somehow it's okay. It's not. It's not okay. But today, you can do what David did. You can come to the blood because it'll cleanse you. But come with a heart that says, a repentant heart that says, I want it gone. I want to be rid of it. I don't want this guilt anymore. I don't like feeling dirty. I want it to be gone. Doesn't mean you're going to be perfect. You're going to have to keep going to that blood. But Jesus said, or John said, if we confess our sin, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sin and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. He's faithful. He'll do it. But you're going to have to keep coming back to the blood. You're going to have to cling to the cross. This morning, have you come to your senses? Have you dealt with sin?